Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath school lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series for the months of January, February, and March of 2016 is entitled Rebellion and Redemption. It's really a bunch of lessons about what we call the Great Controversy. Some people call it the Cosmic Conflict. This particular lesson is entitled Comrades in Arms, and it's about Jesus and his choosing some disciples and how that all worked out. It's lesson number 8 in that series for February 20 of 2016. I think you're going to find it very interesting, as I did. But as always, we need to begin with a word of prayer. Our wonderful Father, you obviously were able to look ahead and see step by step how all this is all going to work out, even in the life of Jesus. But you must have been just incredibly fascinated by the responses of these people that you chose to be your disciples. Help us now to learn from their bloopers, their mistakes, their foibles, not to have to make all those same mistakes ourselves. We thank you for being so patient with them and with us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. How and when and why did Jesus choose disciples? And how many did he choose? We always talk about 12, don't we? Did Jesus choose all 12 of those? Did he choose any others? Well, in Luke, we read about how he sent out 70, or maybe it was 72. Were those disciples or not disciples? How many other people followed him as learners? Disciple is a learner. We know from John chapter 1, verses 33 to 50, that the first disciples followed Jesus, discovered, learned about Jesus after he'd come back from his temptations in the wilderness. Peter, Andrew, James, John, Philip, and Bartholomew, 6 of them, tried to follow Jesus, said, tell us what you're like, tell us what you're doing. John the Baptist had said to them a couple of times, there goes, who is it? The Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. Now, what happened in the next period of time after that experience, you know?
Some of them followed him, some of them didn't.
And they...
Well, they weren't there with him all the time. They
were there periodically. None of them were there with him all the time. A year and a half went by. During that time, we know very, very little about what happened. He was moving about, trying to spread his teachings in the area of Judea. And why was he moving so cautiously in the area of Judea?
Because of opposition.
Because he knew what kind of opposition the Pharisees were going to provide, and later the Sadducees. And he said he was operating, as we sometimes say, under the radar for a year and a half, primarily in Judea, not exclusively in Judea, but primarily in Judea, because he knew that wasn't going to last very long. Then what happened next, you know?
John the Baptist was arrested.
John the Baptist was arrested, and they had already put out warrants for Jesus to be arrested. And he said, it's time that I move on. And he moved to Galilee. And the records we have in Matthew, Mark, and Luke almost exclusively talk about his experiences in Galilee. And then, of course, the last week of his life. All four of the Gospels talk about that last week. But if we had only Matthew, Mark, and Luke, we would think that that Jesus' entire ministry was only about a year long. It's only from the Gospel of John that we discovered that there's 3.5 years involved in this ministry. Luke 9 to 18, the chapters 9 to 18, talks about his final 6 months, his ministry. And where did he primarily minister during those last 6 months?
In Perea.
Where was Perea?
It's on the east side of the Jordan.
Things had become so difficult in Judea and in Galilee now also that they wanted to arrest him. And so Jesus said, okay, I'll just move my operations on the other side of the Jordan River where the Jews didn't have primary jurisdiction. And there he is. Now, once in a while, he would run into Judea and do something, or into Galilee for a little bit, and he'd come back out again. But he didn't dare minister there very consistently, or they would have arrested him. So somewhere about halfway through his ministry, as he began his Galilean portion of his ministry, Jesus said, okay, it's time to choose some disciples. How did that process go down? What happened? How did he go about choosing his disciples? Anybody remember?
He prayed about it.
Okay. Luke 6, verse 12 says, at that time, Jesus went up a hill to pray and spent the whole night there praying to God. When day came, he called his disciples to him and chose 12 of them. What do you think he was praying about that night?
Who we should pick.
I think he was discussing every one of these guys in detail with his father. I don't know how that conversation went down, but boy, I'm looking forward to finding out someday. I'm sure they had a lot of stuff to talk about. So how many disciples did Jesus actually choose?
11.
11?
Yeah, the 12th was Judas, who kind of invited himself in.
In the Desire of Ages, this would be page 294, the first two paragraphs, it says this, while Jesus was preparing the disciples for their ordination, one who had not been summoned urged his presence among them. It was Judas Iscariot, a man who professed to be a follower of Christ. He now came forward soliciting a place in this inner circle of disciples. By joining the apostles, he hoped to secure a high position in the new kingdom. This hope Jesus designed to cut off by the statement of his poverty. What did Jesus say to Judas when he came?
Foxes.
Birds have nests and foxes have their place, but I don't even have a place to lay my head down. So what was he trying to do?
Discourage him.
Judas.
Didn't work, did it? The disciples were anxious that Judas should become one of their number. He was of commanding appearance, a man of keen discernment and executive ability, and they commended him to Jesus as one who would greatly assist him in his work. They were surprised that Jesus received him so coolly. Wow. We shouldn't forget that there are many other followers of Jesus, some of whom served a very important role in his ministry, and some were women, including some rich women. How many disciples followed Jesus? Who were they? What do we know about those disciples? And I would like to read you this very interesting passage I think we need to look at more often. It's found in the first three verses of Luke chapter 8. Sometime later, Jesus traveled through towns and villages preaching the good news about the kingdom of God. The 12 disciples went with him, and how many did that include Judas? Yes, it did. And so did some women who had been healed of evil spirits and diseases. Mary, who was called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had been driven out. Joanna, whose husband Chus was an officer in Herod's court, she was a politician's wife. And Susanna and many other women who used their own resources to help Jesus and his disciples. Who took care of Jesus and his disciples?
Women.
All these women.
Wow. How often do we talk about the women disciples?
Not very often, certainly not these days.
Were they ordained?
Wow. Well, let me ask a couple of questions. Clearly, there were many other followers who wished they could be a part of that inner circle who traveled with Jesus. How would you feel? Now, let's be honest. How would you feel about a young pastor who was traveling around with a former demon-possessed prostitute, the wife of a high government official, and many other women? You'd be real comfortable with that?
Didn't seem to hurt Jimmy Swaggart.
Okay. Let's not get too personal here.
Where were they? Were they staying in motels or?
Are you kidding?
What's happening here?
No, they would come to a village and you'd go into the square in the city and you hope that someone will offer you a place to stay. Stay in somebody's house. Or sleep in the
Not a lot of people.
In the city
center.
Yeah, it is.
Would people from Mary's old life even recognize her after she had become
that known is Jesus? A good question, and I don't know any place to find a specific answer to that.
She might recognize them.
Maybe they were hoping they wouldn't mention her. She wouldn't mention them, right? Well, try to imagine yourself in God's position when it came time to choose Jesus' disciples. Every possible choice had numerous foibles. What do we know about the characteristics of the ones that Jesus chose? And I would like to read some very interesting words. These are Desire of Ages, page 250, paragraph 1. Jesus chose unlearned fishermen because they had not been schooled in the traditions and erroneous customs of their time. Is she saying that the main qualification to become a disciple of Jesus is not to have any education?
Humble and teachable is what she was.
Certainly don't want to go to the seminary.
Keep that up.
You
don't want to have the wrong teachings firmly ingrained into your head so that you can't change.
Absolutely.
You have to unlearn them.
And they had enough wrong teachings in their heads even with their amount of experience. They were men of native ability. Now, we can understand why that would be important. And they were humble and teachable. That's really important. Men whom he could educate for his work. In the common walks of life, there is many a man patiently treading the round of daily toil like us here, unconscious that he possesses powers which, if called into action, would raise him to an equality with the world's most honored men.
That was a good quote there about that they're humble and teachable, and that's a minimum requirement for heaven, is it not?
Exactly. The touch of a skillful hand is needed to arouse those dormant faculties. It was such men that Jesus called to be his co-laborers, and he gave them the advantage of association with himself. Never had the world's great man such a teacher. When the disciples came forth from the Savior's training, they were no longer ignorant and uncultured. They had become like him in mind and character, and men took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. Do you remember when they said that? In Acts 4:13?
In the temple after Christ was out of the picture.
Remember that this is now after Jesus is resurrected, after Pentecost, and Peter and John are told, absolutely, you must not say anything more about this man Jesus. They were thrown in prison. They came to get him out of prison the next day to investigate them, and they weren't in the prison. Where were they? They were back in the temple preaching. So they arrested him. They took him to the Sanhedrin. Of course, the Sanhedrin was right. It was a part of the temple, really. Took him in there, and they're quizzing them. And what happens? I mean, this is the Peter who melted when a woman pointed a finger at him.
The priest marveled at what they heard.
The members of the council were amazed to see how bold Peter and John were and to learn that they were ordinary men of no education, meaning they didn't get their education from us, right?
They had gone to the schools of the prophet.
They realized then that they had been companions of Jesus. That's the important thing. Incredible. Well, look at the story in Luke 5, 1-11. One day, Jesus was standing on the shore of Lake Gennesaret, which is another word for Galilee, or it's even sometimes called the Lake of Tiberias, while the people pushed their way up to him to listen to the word of God. He saw two boats pulled up on the beach. The fishermen had left them and were washing the nets. Jesus got into one of the boats. It belonged to Simon. And Simon's another name for who?
Peter.
And asked him to push off a little from the shore. Jesus sat in the boat and taught the crowd. So, because the shore is coming around like this, so he's sitting in the boat out here, and so a bigger crowd is able to, you know, not only could hear him better, but of course, if they couldn't reach him, they wouldn't be asking for miracles and interrupting his speech and all this kind of stuff. When he finished speaking, he said to Simon, push the boat out a little further to the deep water, and you and your partners let down your nets for a catch. Now, what kind of occupation was Jesus trained in?
Carpentry.
He was carpenter, wasn't he? And who is these people he's telling to go out into the clear water in the middle of the day and put down their nets?
Yeah, fishermen, and they'd been up all night and got nothing.
Master, Simon answered, we worked hard all night long and caught nothing. But if you say so, I will let down the nets. They let them down and caught such a large number of fish that the nets were about to break. They motioned their partners, come in the other boat, come help us. They came and filled both boats so full of fish that the boats were about to sink. Those are good-sized boats, I can tell you. I've been to Capernaum, where this place where this happened, and they actually dug up one of these boats from the days of Jesus, probably not Peter's boat or John's boat, we don't know who it belonged to, but it had been buried in the mud there for 2,000 years. And they dug it up, and you can see it. When Simon Peter saw what had happened, he fell on his knees before Jesus and said, go away from me, Lord, I'm a sinful man. He and the others with him were all amazed at the large number of fish they had caught. The same was true of Simon's partners, James and John, the sons of Zebedee. Jesus said to Simon, don't be afraid. From now on, you'll be catching people. They pulled the boats up on the beach, left everything, and that included the entire load of fish, and followed Jesus.
They left it to their families, maybe.
Yes.
Elsewhere we're told that James and John fished with their father, so maybe they left it with him. Try to imagine yourself following Jesus along the beach that day as larger and larger crowds are trying to get near him. He stepped into Peter's boat. We've already read what happened. Try to imagine what it had been like, what must have been going through Peter's head. The lifelong fisherman, as a young carpenter, was instructing him about when and how to catch fish. All night, Peter and his companions had been struggling with what they were going to do with their lives. As much as they wanted to follow Jesus, they had many questions. And I quote once again, here's from Ellen White, Signs of the Times, May 6th of 1908, a very important passage. The discourse ended. Jesus turned to Peter and bade him launch out into the sea and let down his net for a draught. But Peter was disheartened. All night he had taken nothing. During the lonely hours, he had thought of the fate of John the Baptist. Where was John the Baptist at this point in time?
In jail.
He was languishing alone in his dungeon. He had thought of the prospect before Jesus and his followers, and of the ill success of the mission to Judea, and the malice of the priests and rabbis. Even his own occupation had failed him. And as he watched by the empty nets, the future had seemed dark with discouragement. Master, he said, we have toiled all night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. Was that a good idea?
It convinced him, it convinced the disciples, those four disciples of Jesus' divinity, yeah, that they should follow him. So, yes.
If God has said it, I believe it, and that's all there is to it? Is that?
No.
No? Think about the experience of the disciples. How many miracles had they seen Jesus perform? Unnumbered miracles. We don't even know how many. Ellen White says that in some places he would go through a village and not one single person in the village would be sick when he came out the other side. They had heard him preach incredible sermons. They had seen him cast out devils. I'm sure they had seen him raise people from the dead. How do you think Satan reacted in each of those situations?
With this kind of an experience and an effect on the communities in which he visited, mm-hmm, how come the Bible is the only one that has any accounts of this? How come there aren't Josephus comments some things? But, you know, I would think this would be pretty big headlines. Why isn't this
Josephus
in Roman records someplace, and why? I mean, this would be we've got more stuff about Buddha than we have about Jesus.
Are the Romans going to talk about slaves? Their underlings, their captives.
This is pretty powerful stuff. You know, some of these people had to have been relatives of centurions
and
Herod and everybody else.
Yeah. Herod knew about it.
So how come there's nothing?
Pilate knew about it. Well, his wife was convinced.
Isn't this a good argument that, you know, all of this stuff is made up? It's just in the Bible. There's no other record of it.
Well, actually, Josephus does talk about it a little bit. Not a lot, but some.
Well, is there any other example somewhere of writings during that time that you can pull up and say, see, this guy has a whole bunch of stuff?
Well, they've dug up whole libraries of and all. There was not like they didn't write. Paul was writing letters, so all kinds of people were writing letters and documents and historians, and they even have architectural plans from back in those days.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, they didn't have newspapers back then.
No.
We don't know that.
Well, who had a printing press that could...
The rest of the disciples, like Peter, hopefully realized their weaknesses. At least to some extent, were ready to recognize Jesus as their mentor or leader and Savior. Luke 5:11 tells us that they forsook all and followed him. What do you think they said to their families, especially their wives and their children? Did it seem like they were going off on a wild goose chase? Have any of you ever gotten involved in some kind of thing and gone home and said, wife, guess what?
Well, what kind of faith do you think it is that they left? Weren't they kind of had visions of grandeur, of this guy could be the big general that's going to...
They had just had a whole night of worrying that the whole thing was going to be a boondoggle. They were going to be killed.
Probably a lot, what, during that time?
Yeah. I read it to you just a moment ago. John the Baptist is in prison. They've got warrants out for his arrest. I mean, you know, are you going to follow this guy? I mean, this guy's a wanted criminal as far as the authorities were concerned. You going to follow him?
I don't know about that.
Oh, yeah.
Well, there were
it's clearly documented.
There were lots of messiahs running around, that there were people who would think, well, this guy's it, so I'm going to join him.
The only people that were after them was jealous Pharisees.
And they were the Jewish leaders. They were the people,
well,
the head of the government.
He didn't have any trouble with them right now.
Well,
did they?
He did. That's why
he didn't have any trouble with the Romans right then.
Well, he
did. That's why he left Judea, because he was having trouble with the Pharisees and the Sadducees.
And he had problems with the Romans way early on when he was a baby, because Herod sent out and killed all the babies. So.
But you're talking about the beginning of his ministry in practicality.
Mm-hmm.
You think he was that?
Do you think if the devil managed to manipulate things to get John the Baptist arrested, he wouldn't have loved to arrest Jesus?
Yeah, John the Baptist was out there calling Herod's wife something, names and things like that. Jesus wasn't doing that kind of stuff. I could see why he would get canned, thrown in jail.
What do you think Jesus had to say about Herod's wife?
Well, show me what he had to say about it.
No record of that, is there?
I don't think there is any record. He may not have condemned anybody during that time. Well, John might have been doing it left and right, and that's why he got thrown in jail.
The high priests were hand in glove with the Roman leaders. The high priests got their position from the Romans.
They paid money.
They did. The
Romans weren't the ones that were jealous of him at the time. It was the Pharisees.
How they
got there is kind of irrelevant.
The point I'm getting at is when push came to shove and the priests needed a little help, they went to the government to say, hey, we're going to do so and so and so. So they were after him.
Mark 3. Verse 14 says some interesting things. And he chose 12 whom he named apostles. Apostles are those who are sent out. I have chosen you to be with me, he told them. I will also send you out to preach, and you will have authority to drive out demons. Do you think Judas had the authority to drive out demons?
Yep.
Did he raise anybody from the dead?
Maybe.
Notice that Jesus recognized that before they could become real representatives of God here on planet Earth, they must spend a significant amount of time with him. There have been many people down through the ages since that time who have claimed to be faithful followers of Jesus, but who, in fact, were not. There is, I'm reading now Review and Herald, September 18, 1888, from Ellen White. There is, however, a large class who do not deal dishonestly and who still profess to be followers of the dear Redeemer. They claim to be representatives of Christ, but in character, they represent the worst and greatest enemy of our Lord. So these people are claiming to be followers of Jesus. Where do you suppose they're found?
In the churches today.
In the churches, exactly. And they are what? The worst and greatest enemy of our Lord. Wow. So how are we to spend time with Jesus when we cannot see him or hear him physically among us? It is a law. This is Great Controversy, page 555. We refer to it quite frequently. It is a law, both of the intellectual and the spiritual nature, that by beholding we become changed. The mind gradually adapts itself to the subjects upon which it is allowed to dwell. It becomes assimilated to that which it is accustomed to love and reverence.
So that's why we're here around this table.
Yeah. One of the most incredible experiences that happened to convince the disciples that following Jesus was the right thing to do is recorded in Matthew 8, 23 to 27. Let me just read that really quickly. Jesus got into a boat and his disciples went with him. Suddenly a fierce storm hit the lake and the boat was in danger of sinking. But Jesus was asleep. The disciples went to him and woke him up. "Save us, Lord," they said. "We're about to die." "Why are you so frightened?" Jesus answered. How little faith you have." Then he got up, ordered the winds and the waves to stop, and there was a great calm.
It's interesting that they thought that he could save them.
Everyone was amazed. "What kind of man is this?" they say. "Even the winds and the waves obey him."
If they're amazed at that, what did they expect he was going to do? Get out and help row?
Well, okay.
Guide the tiller?
Ellen White is going to spell this out in some more detail. This is a fairly lengthy passage, but it has some very significant things here. Desire of Ages, page 334 to 335. I'd like you to follow this story along and think how you would have reacted in this situation. The sun had set, and the blackness of night settled down upon the stormy sea. The waves, lashed into fury by the howling winds, dashed fiercely over the disciples' boat and threatened to engulf it. Those hardy fishermen had spent their lives upon the lake, and daytime or nighttime?
Yeah, nighttime.
They fished at night. They were out there almost every night. And had guided their craft safely through many a storm. But now their strength and skill availed nothing. What might have been different about this storm?
I think the devil was trying to sink the ship.
I really think, in light of everything I read about this, that this was the devil saying, let's get rid of the whole bunch of them all at once. Just drown them all, including Jesus.
And it wasn't just Jesus and the disciples, as we're going to see later in Mark 4. It's other people, other boats with other people.
They were helpless in the grasp of the tempest, and hope failed them as they saw their boat was filling. Absorbed in their efforts to save themselves, they thought, we're the fishermen, we're going to do this, right? They had forgotten that Jesus was on board. Now, seeing their labor vain and only death before them, they remembered at whose command they had set out to cross the sea. And Jesus was their only hope. In their helplessness and despair, they cried, "Master, Master!" But the dense darkness hid him from their sight. Their voices were drowned by the roaring of the tempest, and there was no reply. It's amazing that Jesus could be sleeping through all of that. Doubt and fear assailed them. Had Jesus forsaken them? Was he who had conquered disease and demons and even death powerless to help his disciples now? Was he unmindful of them in their distress? Again they call. But there is no answer, except the shrieking of the angry blast. Already their boat was sinking. A moment, and apparently they will be swallowed up by the hungry waters. Suddenly, a flash of lightning pierces the darkness, and they see Jesus lying asleep, undisturbed by the tumult. in amazement and despair, they exclaimed, "Master, carest thou not that we perish? How can he rest so peacefully while they are in danger and battling with death?" Their cry arouses Jesus. As the lightning's glare reveals him, they see the peace of heaven in his face. They read in his glance self-forgetful, tender love, and their hearts turning to him cry, "Lord, save us, we perish." Never did a soul utter that cry unheeded. As the disciples grasp their oars to make a last effort, Jesus rises. He stands in the midst of his disciples while the tempest, I wish I could see this. Someday I hope to see this. While the tempest rages, the waves break over them and the lightning illuminates his countenance. He lifts his hand, so often employed in the deeds of mercy, and says to the angry sea, "Peace, be still." And the storm ceases. The billows sink to rest, the clouds roll away, and the stars shine forth.
So you think Satan caused that storm?
Absolutely.
Now, don't you think that Satan knew that Jesus could walk on water?
Well,
don't you think that Jesus knew that he could make Jesus, that Jesus could make everybody else walk on water?
The devil sometimes is not too bright.
No, I think it was, I think it still works to have the Lord, the God actually do it.
Yeah.
Because how else are you going to teach anybody?
Oh, I think God did it. Yeah, that's your question, yeah.
Well, I mean, he caused a storm.
Oh, I don't think so.
Well, what good is it for Satan to do it? Because he knows he couldn't drown him.
Well,
he walks on water.
But he had an opportunity. Why not take it?
Come on, you guys. I think has to be a little bit irrational here.
Yeah. I'm quite certain that Satan was responsible for that storm.
You go back to Job, and certainly Satan brought on the disasters on Job's family.
Yeah. Yeah.
Why is he not going to try to do it to the church, the church that's going to be his opponents in the future? Why is
do the storm is because he would know that Jesus can walk on water.
That's what I'm saying. The devil, that's too rational for the devil.
Oh, I think the devil is very rational. I think he's more rational than you think. No. I wouldn't say that. I don't think we understand.
Anybody who could live in God's presence and turn against him is stupid.
Okay, I guess you know.
Well, a hush fell upon the disciples. Even Peter did not attempt to express the awe that filled his heart. The boats that had set out to accompany Jesus had been in the same peril with that of the disciples. Terror and despair had seized their occupants. But the command of Jesus brought quiet to the scene of tumult. The fury of the storm had driven the boats into close proximity, and all on board beheld the miracle. In the calm that followed, fear was forgotten. The people whispered among themselves, "What manner of man is this that even the winds and the seas obey him?" Desire of Ages 3:34 to 3:35. Now I want you to think about this for a moment. Jesus is a carpenter. His boat is filled with fishermen who had spent years out on these waters. They had seen every storm that came along. And here they are. And they see Jesus do this, and they're just flabbergasted.
You know, how many times does it take for you to know that you don't have the strength to save yourself? When does that ever come to anybody?
Yeah.
Well, I think it came to them right then. And the Lord does bring that kind of reality to people so that they understand it.
Yeah.
So that's what makes me think that there's more to this.
Job 1:18 and 19 that Gordon was referring to. Before he had finished speaking, another servant came and said, "Your children were having a feast at the home of your eldest son, when a storm swept in from the desert and blew the house down and killed them all. I am the only one who escaped to tell you." You think the devil would have loved to do that to Jesus and the disciples? Absolutely. And I quote now from Ellen White in a book called Historical Sketches of Foreign Missions of Seventh-day Adventists, which is really a report of her about 2 years or 2.5 years that she spent in Europe. She said, what or who do you think was, I'm sorry, Satan is even now seeking by disasters upon sea and land to seal the fate of as many as possible.
You know, I think Ephesians 6, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against the principalities, against the powers, against the world rulers of this present darkness, against the spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. I think we underestimate how much God has to protect us from everything. Left unchecked, Satan would destroy everything, including his followers.
But think about it. The number one group of people that he would like to destroy on this earth is who? Christians.
Of course.
Yeah, people.
That's rational. To say that Satan is rational, I can't buy it.
Yeah. look from Satan's side for just a moment. If there's any group of people that you would like to get rid of on planet Earth, it would be who? The closer people are to God, the more he wants to get rid of them. I mean, isn't that logical?
Yep.
You want to be logical, that would be it. So is God's spirit being withdrawn? Is Satan being allowed more and more to take control of the elements?
I think definitely.
Does he have anything to do with global warming?
You only have to put the evening news on, you know, things are loosening up.
I may quote one other quote here. Ephesians 5, verse 11.
Yeah.
Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them.
Yeah.
That's what the great controversy is about.
Mm-hmm. Well, how do you think you would have responded if you had been in one of those boats that was caught in that terrible storm and all of a sudden the sea became quiet and calm?
Almost what I hear about going into the eye of a hurricane.
Yeah.
I don't think you'd forget it.
Boy. What did they say to their families when they went home? We were drowning. And this guy raised his hand and said, be quiet.
This is the same one that in Genesis 1 separated the waters.
Yeah.
I mean, who can control water? I mean, look, I guess up in Portland right now they're having a problem with rainwater.
Huge
flooding. They haven't had any history of it as bad as it is right now. So anyway.
The wettest month.
But who can control water by speaking it to it?
Yeah. What weapons does the devil use in the great controversy?
Deception.
Ideas.
Ideas, deception. What weapons does God use? Let's compare
truth.
Them. We know for sure that Satan uses lying. He uses deceit. He uses force if he's allowed to. He uses natural disasters. We read about some of those. Even diseases and murder whenever God allows. And what weapons does God use?
Truth.
Truth? Love? Maybe you might want
education.
To call it gentle persuasion.
Teaching.
Education, teaching.
Disciples.
Does that sound like a fair battle? Truth and love and gentle persuasion, teaching versus force, violence, murder, lying, deceit.
It's the only thing that has stay in power for eternity.
Mm-hmm. Okay, what did Jesus say to the disciples? Don't you have any faith yet? I mean, if we had enough faith, would we be able to stop some of the storms that are happening in our world today? Could you stop a hurricane in its tracks?
Or an earthquake.
These days they take it down to the corner psych unit.
Well, they didn't learn their lessons very well, and unless I'm getting the stories confused, because they're going to land on the other side.
Mm-hmm. And that's a different time, but it's the same story, same idea.
Anyway. Went through something very similar and had seen all this power and how he saved them, and then they get to the other side and these demons come running out, not demons, but demoniacs, and they run like rabbits.
Well, just sort of watching my clock here. Let's go to Matthew 13, 1-9. That same day, Jesus left the house and went to the lakeside where he sat down to teach. The crowd that gathered, this is Matthew 13, gathered round him so large that he got into the boat and sat in it while the crowd stood on the shore. He used parables to teach them many things. Once there was a man who went out to sow corn. This is a British, I have a British version here, so this would be wheat if we were talking U.S. English. As he scattered the seed in the field, some of it fell along the path and the birds came and ate it up. Some of it fell on rocky ground where there was little soil. The seeds soon sprouted because the soil wasn't deep. But when the sun came up, it burnt the young plants, and because the roots had not grown deep enough, the plants soon dried up. Some of the seed fell among thorn bushes, which grew up and choked the plants. But some seeds fell in good soil, and the plants produced corn. Some produced 100 grains, others 60, and others 30. And Jesus concluded, "Listen then, if you have ears." Then the disciples came to Jesus and asked him, "Why do you use parables when you talk to the people?" Jesus answered, "The knowledge about the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, but not to them." Does that sound like God who wants everybody to know the truth?
We get down to verse 34, and he says he did no teaching except by the means of parables.
Now, why would he say that?
And then at the end, at the upper room, he says, "Now I'm going to tell you plainly. I'm not going to talk in parables. I'm going to tell you plainly about the Father. I don't need to pray the Father for you because the Father himself loves you." Mm-hmm. And then the disciple says, "Ah, now you're speaking plainly, mm-hmm. not any parables." So anyway, they're just...
Does this parable help us to understand something about how and why Jesus chose the disciples that he did? How would you choose the good soil disciples? I mean, you know... This might sound like a foolish question, but think about it. I mean, wouldn't we like to be able to go out in the world and figure out who are the people that are going to respond to the gospel? Wouldn't you all love to have witnessing opportunities to people who are eager to hear the good news? Doesn't that sound exciting? It does to me. Well, Satan found it impossible to get Jesus to sin. Satan wanted to do one of three things in his experience with Jesus. Of course, his huge, big goal from day one was to get Jesus to sin. When he saw that he was failing with that job, he thought, okay, if I can't get him to sin, let me make life so difficult for him that he'll give up and just go back to heaven. He doesn't have to sin. He just has to abandon human beings, leave this world to Satan. That was number two. Finally, when Jesus lived through his life, was crucified and died, and now he's buried in the tomb, Satan realizes that the only possibility for him left is to keep that grave shut. Did he succeed?
No.
What happened?
Two angels came and took on the entire... evil forces.
I have to chuckle when I think about this, because I'm sure that Satan and every angel on his side was there trying to keep that grave shut. And God just sent two angels. You know, we read in the Bible, oh, there's 100 Roman soldiers there guarding the tomb. Let me assure you, those 100 Roman soldiers, they were nothing compared to all the other angels and Satan and all his angels that were guarding that tomb. But what happened? They all scattered. There was nothing they could do. One of those angels rolled back the stone, and the other one said, "Jesus, your Father calls you." And he came forth, Desire of Ages says, he came forth from the tomb in his own divine power. For the first time in 33 and a half years, or however long, he actually was able to use his own divine power. So, Satan found it very difficult to get Jesus, to try to tempt Jesus. He couldn't. But the disciples were much easier targets. They seemed to be full of pride, doubt, stubbornness, self-importance, even petty rivalries. They had a lot to learn, but then so do we. Look at some examples. Look at, let's take Luke 9, 46 to 48. Now, this is a chapter, okay? Jesus Luke 9. This is Jesus and his disciples. They're getting down near the end of Jesus' life. An argument broke out among the disciples as to which one of them was the greatest. Jesus knew what they were thinking, so he took a child, stood him by his side, and said to them, "Whoever welcomes this child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me also welcomes the one who sent me, for the one who is least among you all is the greatest." Now, this is a parable and a story that we as Christians have heard repeatedly, probably from the time we were young children. What do you think it really means? Maybe I need to read you one more parable, one more passage from Luke. Luke chapter 22, verses 24 to 30. They have now gone from Jericho up to Jerusalem. The last trip. It's time for the Passover. Okay. Jesus is saying, "Get the Passover ready. I'm going to go and we're going to eat in the upper room." And as they were going up there, an argument broke out among the disciples as to which one of them should be thought of as the greatest. Can you believe that? There still are. This is the night before Jesus is going to be, well, the night when Jesus was going to be betrayed and the night before he died. Jesus said to them, the kings of the pagans have power over their people, and the rulers claim the title friends of the people. But this is not the way it is with you. Rather, the greatest one among you must be like the youngest, and the leader must be like the servant. Who is greater, the one who sits down to eat or the one who serves? The one who sits down, of course. But I am among you as one who serves. Incredible.
When they talk about greater, what comes to your mind when that word's used? They translate it that way.
Yeah. It could be either greater in power and strength, or it could be older. It could be in higher preference. Higher standing. Of course, what they were hoping, they wanted to be prime ministers.
Well, then it's rank.
Well, it could mean that too.
That's what it means, because mm-hmm. because I'm a higher rank than you are.
Mm-hmm. Who's going to be the highest in the cabinet?
Yeah.
And they even said they wanted one wanted to be on the right and one wanted to be on the left. What they didn't realize, what they didn't realize was in a couple days there's going to be a couple of guys on the right and the left.
Yeah. Matthew 20, verses 20 to 22. Let's read it. Then the wife of Zebedee came to Jesus with her two sons, bowed before him, and asked him a favor. "What do you want?" Jesus asked her, as if he didn't already know. She answered, "Promise me that these two sons of mine will sit at your right and your left when you are king."
And she didn't know the next very short period of time there were going to be a sign above Jesus' head, King of the Jews, and there were two guys on the right and the left.
Don't know what you're asking right. for, Jesus answered the sons. "Can you drink the cup of suffering that I'm about to drink?" "We can," they answered. "You will indeed drink from my cup," Jesus told them, "but I do not have the right to choose who will sit on my right and my left. These places belong to those whom my Father has prepared, for whom my Father has prepared them." And who was the first of the disciples to be killed? Not counting Judas, of course, who killed himself. Who was the first of the faithful disciples to be killed? James.
James. Threw him off the ball. Yeah.
Yeah. And who was the last of the disciples to die?
John. But they didn't kill him. They attempted.
No. He died of old age. They tried to kill him, but...
he was the only one that did not ultimately die of old age. Non-natural death. He died of old age, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Well, who do you suppose was behind that request by the mother of the sons of Zebedee? Maybe this verse will give us a clue. This is Isaiah 14, verse 14. "You said you would climb to the tops of the clouds and be like the Almighty. But instead, you've been brought down to the deepest part of the world of the dead." Who's it talking about there?
Satan.
By the way, in Mark 10, the same story, it says that the James and John came, the disciples themselves came and asked Jesus rather than the mother.
Mm-hmm. Probably some combination of that.
Maybe all of them.
Jesus had repeatedly told his disciples that he would end up going to Jerusalem, being arrested, being handed over to the Romans, and finally being crucified. But they could not comprehend what he could possibly be talking about. And my incredible verse in the Bible is found in Luke 18:31-34. Listen to these words. Jesus took the 12 disciples aside. Now they're traveling on the road from Jericho up that road where this Good Samaritan did his thing, up that very steep road to Jerusalem. And it's a steep road, I can tell you. And Jesus, while they're apparently Jesus found a place where they could, and they were traveling with a whole crowd of people. Imagine there were hundreds and hundreds of people trying to get to Jerusalem in time for the Passover. Jesus took the 12 disciples aside and said to them, "Listen, we're going to Jerusalem where everything the prophets wrote about the Son of Man will come true. He will be handed over to the Gentiles, who will mock him, insult him, and spit on him. Has he said anything that was difficult to understand so far? They will whip him and kill him, but 3 days later he will rise to life." Anything difficult to understand there? But the disciples did not understand any of these things. The meaning of the words was hidden from them, and they did not know what Jesus was talking about.
It didn't fit their paradigm.
It did not fit their plan. This crowd that they were with were absolutely certain that Jesus was going to go up there, and you know, a couple days later they were going to usher him into Jerusalem, saying, "Hosanna, the King of the Jews!" Da 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 da. 2 days later, 2 days after this, they were sure they were escorting Jesus to be the king. And the disciples, I'm sure they were ecstatic. They were so excited. Judas was on, you know, highest position here. Wow. Yeah.
Did his performing miracles have anything to do with how they came about this thinking? How they came to this thinking? That he was, well, they see all these powerful miracles, and mm-hmm. Is that why they thought
he would be king?
Yeah, more that this.
Well, that was certainly one of the reasons why they were hoping he would be king. He could easily help them beat the Romans. If anybody got injured in the war against the Romans, he would just heal them like that. And
well, that
if they
was
need
the interpretation back then of the Messiah, yeah. That he would become king and that he would bring the nation of Israel back to the glory of Solomon again.
Yeah.
That's what they were going to do. And that's part of the reasons, I think, that the motivation that the disciples had at the beginning.
That incredible experience of the followers of Jesus on Resurrection Sunday are almost impossible to imagine.
Why is it the disciples had such an erroneous...
All of the Jews had that. Jesus' mother had that same idea.
And why is that? I mean,
because that's what they wanted to happen.
I guess where I'm going with this is it would seem to me that it would be easy to draw that conclusion from the passages in the Old Testament, which is they just read that and read a very literal interpretation. And my next question is, do we make the same mistake today? Do we read in the New Testament?
You didn't have to ask that, did you?
How Jesus is going to come in the clouds of heaven, and we're waiting for this clouds of heaven when... Mm-hmm. Or how do we know we're not misinterpreting that? We're not just making the same old mistake that they did.
Well,
that's for next lesson, and for next Sabbath.
Yeah, maybe.
And these disciples who don't understand are the ones who've spent all this time with Jesus, who we learned about, who are teachable, willing to learn, and yet what had they learned? They had all the information, but they hadn't put it together yet until after the death, resurrection, and
is that what's going to happen at the time of trouble?
Think about the walk to Emmaus on the Resurrection Sunday. Jesus with those two lesser-known disciples. Why do you think the two disciples were not able to recognize Jesus? Had Satan blinded their eyes, or did God send them temporary blindness? Or was it just natural?
I don't know. It's a weird story.
They were changing their... I mean, they had an interpretation of the scriptures at the beginning, and this happened with Jesus, which didn't fit. Mm-hmm. So in Emmaus, he just explained to them, it does fit, but you have to look at it this way.
Yeah.
The paradigm shift, wasn't it?
Yeah. Might Jesus have actually caused the temporary blindness in order to get them to think clearly through his arguments from the Old Testament before he revealed to them who he was? Now think what would have happened if Jesus showed up. They're just outside of Jerusalem. They're headed for Emmaus, and Jesus says, I'm Jesus, I can answer your questions. What would they have done?
Oh,
turned
okay.
around immediately and headed back in town, right?
Yeah.
There would have there'd been no walk to Emmaus.
No learning. No teaching.
No learning, no. Ellen White.
Understanding.
What?
There would have been no understanding.
Yeah. Ellen White suggested that they were so absorbed in their gloom and disappointment that they did not observe him closely. Desire of Ages 795, paragraph 2. When the disciples reached their destination, presumably their homes at Emmaus, they urged Jesus to stay with them. Once again, Ellen White said, had the disciples failed to press their invitation, they would not have known that their traveling companion was the risen Lord. Desire of Ages 800, paragraph 3.
So she's saying that he looked exactly the same, everything was like before,
remember
and
that
they were so down in the dumps that they couldn't recognize it because of that?
I just read you the words. When they discovered that Jesus was the one who had been speaking to them, they jumped up, left their food behind, and raced back to Jerusalem. I hope they took some with them. Repeating over and over again the words recorded in Luke 24:32, wasn't it like a fire burning in us when he talked to us on the road and explained the scriptures to us? Is that how you feel about the truths of scripture? When here in the flesh, Jesus cast out demons, gave hope to the hopeless, showed people how to live out God's agape love, healed the centurion servant, raised a widow's dead son, stilled a storm, freed the demoniac at Gadara of his demons, healed a woman who had been bleeding for 12 years, raised Jairus' dead daughter, even raised Lazarus from the dead after he'd been dead for 4 days. All that he did, and so much more, and yet people still struggle to believe in him. Even Christ's own disciples were slow to learn and to understand. Notwithstanding their love for him and their reverence for his character, their faith in his being the Son of God wavered. These are Ellen White's words. Their frequent reference to the traditions of the fathers and their continual misunderstanding of his discourses showed how difficult it was for them to free themselves from superstition. Incredible. Think of the different ways in which people have responded. And I don't have time to read the rest of this. I hope you'll have a chance to look at our website and get the rest of this. But what an incredible experience. Jesus with those disciples from the beginning of his ministry to the end, and they still couldn't understand what in the world he was talking about. And then all of a sudden, on crucifixion weekend, they had their whole world turned upside down, and their eyes came open. They realized that Jesus wasn't here to set up a worldly kingdom. He was here to set up a spiritual kingdom, and you and I can be a part of it. Father, we bow before you in humble recognition of our weakness. Like the disciples, we have made many mistakes. We are so prone to follow the devil, to be tempted by him, to fall into sin. Help us to be among those who will one day have the privilege of standing firm, not falling, in the face of the devil himself, witnessing to the truth about you, so that you may come again very quickly, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.